Experiment 18 in Chem 1212 is titled Introduction to Acids and Bases. And in this experiment, we're going to investigate acids and bases both in everyday household products and in solutions that we've prepared ourselves from pure compounds. So in the first part of the experiment, we'll investigate the pH of common household products and see that it varies over a substantial range depending on the function and purpose of the product. In the rest of the experiment, we'll investigate solutions that we've made up ourselves. Specifically, we'll look at the effect of dilution, or lowering the concentration of an acid or base, on its pH, and then we'll move on to investigating pH indicators, which are weak acids whose acidic and basic forms have different colors, so that we can identify the pH of a solution in a qualitative way based on the color of an indicator that's added to it. Before we address this experiment in detail, I wanted to give some general ideas about acids and bases so that we have a good foundation. Let's first begin with Bronsted acids and bases. A Bronsted acid is a species that gives up or surrenders protons in water. So there are a couple of things you should notice about this general chemical equation I've shown for acids that you see here. The first thing is the aqueous phase designator in red. We're talking about acids in water here. Bronsted acids and bases can exist in other solvents, but for the purposes of this experiment and for the purposes of most of Chem 1212, we'll think only about acids and bases in water. The second thing you should notice is that what's happening to the species HA is a proton is being separated from it, and A minus, or what's called the conjugate base of HA, is left behind. That's the definition of an acid. It gives up protons to the solution that it's placed in. A base does exactly the opposite. It takes up protons from the surrounding solution. So a base in aqueous solution can react with aqueous H plus, or what I'll call the solvated proton, to form HB plus, which is called the conjugate acid of the base. And again here, notice that all of this is occurring in water. We'll deal with bases in water exclusively in this experiment. In pure water, the concentration of H plus is 10 to the negative 7 moles per liter. This comes about because water can react with itself and pull a proton from itself to form what you can think of as H3O plus and OH minus. So what happens then when we add an acid or a base to water? What happens to the concentration of H plus? Well, we can see from the chemical equations right here that the acid generates H plus. And so when an acid is placed in water, the concentration of H plus should increase, and that's what we observe. When a base is added to water, on the other hand, it takes up protons from the solution. So when a base is added, the concentration of H plus should decrease, and the concentration of hydroxide, which is the conjugate base of water, should increase. In the first part of the experiment, we'll investigate several household products with a variety of different pH values. The acids and bases that are present in these products cause their pHs to deviate from that of pure water. In the second part of this experiment, we'll explore the relationship between acid strength and pH, and investigate how dilution affects the pH of a solution. Before getting into the details of dilution and how that might affect the pH, let's talk about strong versus weak acids. A strong acid is one that completely dissociates in water. Hydrochloric acid, or HCl, is a great example. When HCl is placed in water, it dissociates almost completely into solvated protons and chloride anion. Notice the large black bold forward arrow and the very small reverse arrow, which shows that at equilibrium, HCl in water is almost completely H plus and Cl minus. The equilibrium constant for this process, then, is far, far greater than 1, and this is the definition of a strong acid. Strong acids are nice because we can essentially assume that they're completely dissociated. So we can ignore HCl completely, just think of the HCl as H plus and Cl minus once it's been put into water. Not all acids are this strong, however. For example, acetic acid shows a much more finely balanced equilibrium between the associated form, what I've written here as HOAC, and the dissociated solvated proton and acetate conjugate base. Here, the Ka is generally less than 1, and for weak acids in water, it falls between 10 to the negative 3 and 10 to the negative 10. The pKa for acetic acid is right around 10 to the negative 5. This is a weak acid because it doesn't completely dissociate in water, and we need to consider the acid-base equilibrium when we want to figure out the concentration of protons due to this acid being placed in water. We won't see complete dissociation, but we can use the ideas of chemical equilibrium to calculate how much H+ is formed when we put some concentration of HOAC into water. In the second part of this experiment, we'll start with a 0.1 molar solution of an acid in water, and I've called that A here, and we'll measure the pH of that. From there, we'll take 2 milliliters of that A solution and dilute it with 18 milliliters of water to a total volume of 20 milliliters. What you should notice here is that this is a 1 to 10 dilution of solution A, so the concentration of HA is now 1/10 of what it used to be. We'll again measure the pH of this, and then we'll take 2 milliliters of that solution B and dilute that with 18 milliliters of water once again. So this is a 1 to 10 dilution of solution B, and with respect to solution A, it's a 1 to 100 dilution. So the concentration of solution C is 1/100th of what it was in solution A. Before you get into the lab and start measuring these pHs, take a minute to think about what you expect the pHs to be. For a weak acid that's 0.1 molar, let's say, and then a weak acid that's 0.01 molar, 1/10 of that, and 0.001 molar, 1/100th of that. How do you think the pH will change with dilution? Will it increase? Will it decrease? Will it move toward a particular value? Another thing to think about is how is the percent dissociation affected by dilution? In other words, how much of the acid present is dissociated into H+ and the conjugate base as we add more water? You can think about this using Le Chatelier's principle in a way, and considering the fact that although it's not shown on the left-hand side of each equilibrium, water does figure into this dissociation process, and it's important for solvating the products, solvating the conjugate base and H+. In this experiment, we'll also investigate acidic and basic salts. And I want to talk a little bit about how these work because they can be a little tricky to wrap one's mind around. The first thing I'll mention is that there are many salts that look like the form you see here in black. HA forms the cationic part of the salt, and B forms the anionic part of the salt. And if you learn to see the HA plus and B minus as acids and bases, you'll see why adding a salt to water can potentially affect the pH of the water. A common problem that we might come across is to determine the pH of a solution to which we've added some quantity of salt. And so, for example, for something like NH4Cl, we can imagine this really as NH4 plus and Cl minus, and we can ask, how does adding this salt to water affect the pH of that water? The key insight here is to see that the NH4 plus cation is really an acid, and the Cl minus anion is really a base. And so the relative strength of the cation and anion as acids and bases respectively is going to impact the resulting pH and tell us whether it will be lower than 7 or greater than 7. To determine the pH of a solution containing a salt, the trick is to compare the Ka of the cation, the Ka of the acid, to the Kb of the base. This is just a quantitative way of saying that we need to find the stronger acid or base. And a lot of the time you can do this by inspection without going to the numbers. So for example, in the case of NH4 plus Cl minus, if we recognize that HCl, the conjugate acid of chloride, is a very strong acid, we can reason that the conjugate base, Cl minus, is very weak. While NH3 is a mild base, which tells us that NH4 plus might be a mild acid as well. So the stronger acid or base here is the cation. The cation is a stronger acid than the anion is a base. From here, the next step is to write down the either acid dissociation or base association equilibrium with water for the acid or base. So for the example we're working with here, NH4 plus can dissociate into solvated proton and NH3. And our goal is to determine the concentration of H plus formed by this reaction at equilibrium. So essentially, at this point, we're doing the ice dance, preparing an ice table. We know the starting concentration of NH4+. Let's say we started with a 0.1 molar solution. In other words, we added 0.1 moles to 1 liter of water. We'll know that from the problem parameters. We know the initial concentration of H+ is 10 to the negative 7 molar, since we added the salt to pure water. A lot of the time, you can ignore that 10 to the negative 7, but I just wanted to write it here to be exhaustive. And we didn't start with any NH3. The salt was completely NH4 plus Cl minus, so we can add a zero there. After going through the ice calculations, we can arrive at the equilibrium molarities of each. And the most important equilibrium molarity when it comes to thinking about Acidic or basic behavior is the concentration of H plus at equilibrium. The negative base 10 log of that concentration is equal to the solution pH at equilibrium. So I've jumped over a lot of the nitty-gritty details here, but the overall important lesson to take from this is that a salt HAB that can be broken apart into HA plus and B minus can serve either as an acid or a base in water, and the relative strength of the acid and base dictate what the pH is going to be. Qualitatively, what we can say is that if the cation is a stronger acid than the anion is a base, the pH will be less than 7 because the acidic behavior of the cation is dominating. On the other hand, if the anion is a stronger base than the cation is an acid, then the pH ought to be greater than 7 because the basic behavior of the anion is going to dominate. Briefly, although it's not terribly important for this lab, I'll mention what happens for MX salts where M is a metal cation. Here there are no protons to give up, and so we're not exactly talking about Bronsted acidity in this case. A good example is FeCl3, which in water dissociates into Fe3+ and 3Cl- anions. This is an acidic salt, but we don't see any protons in the structure, so it's difficult to imagine where the protons are coming from. We can imagine Cl- acting as a base, but it's a bit difficult to see how Fe3+ can act as an acid. The trick here is to understand that water can coordinate to the Fe3+, and that acidifies the protons in water. So when water reacts with Fe3+ cation, what we get, in fact, is iron hydroxide, FeOH3, and 3 solvated protons. Looking at this reaction, we can see how water coordination to Fe3+ can actually release protons. The formation of iron hydroxide drives that release. We can think of the equilibrium constant for this reaction as a kind of quote-unquote Ka, in the sense that protons show up on the product side. And we can use that Ka to figure out the equilibrium pH of the solution in just the same way we use the Ka of NH4+ in the example above, determine the equilibrium H plus concentration, and then use the negative base 10 log of that to determine the pH at equilibrium. Now, this process of forming the hydroxide and releasing protons is not important for all cations. In fact, it's the Lewis acidity of the cation that dictates whether it will do this or not. More Lewis acidic cations release more protons in water. And so here I'll ask you to think about for a second whether this process is important for Na+. Think about the relative Lewis acidity of Na+ and Fe3+, and whether you think Na+ has the ability to release protons in water through a similar process, and why or why not. In the final part of the experiment, we'll investigate pH indicators, which qualitatively indicate the pH of a solution as acidic or basic. pH indicators are weak acids, and so they're characterized by this acid dissociation process in water that involves HA breaking apart into solvated proton and the conjugate base A-. But the neat thing about an indicator is that its conjugate base and acidic form are different colors. So in this video, I'll use the example of a conjugate base that's red and an acid form that's blue. We can take this indicator, and let's imagine we can get it in solid form as the acid HA, and add it to a solution of unknown pH. The resulting solution color depends on the pH of the solution, and so in that way, HA indicates the pH, and that's why it's called an indicator. To bring a little bit more of a quantitative feel to this, we can ask, at what pH do we go from a blue solution to a red solution? When the pKa equals the pH, we have equal concentrations of HA and A-. So at that point, we have what you might think of as a purple solution. And as we move to a lower pH, HA starts to dominate because we have an excess of protons, which drives that weak acid equilibrium to the left, forming more of the blue HA species. On the other hand, if we're in a basic solution that has a relatively low concentration of H+, that will drive this equilibrium to the right, and we'll end up with a red solution because the conjugate base, A-, is dominating over the acidic form. In a perfect world, we would be able to see quantitatively when the pH moved from below the pKa to above the pKa. But in practice, there tends to be a range where the color change occurs because as the red starts to build in, for example, as we increase the pH, it becomes difficult to say exactly when the color changes. And so we might see a color change depending on the quality of our eyes and the specific details of the indicator's colors anywhere between one unit above the pKa and one unit below the pKa in pH. The purpose of the third part of the experiment is to determine that so-called crossover pH for phenylphthalein and one other indicator. So we'll start with a solution of the indicator that's approximately neutral, let's say, a pH of about 7. From there, we'll add acid or base to this solution to determine when the color change occurs, and we'll be measuring the pH throughout, so we'll be able to record the pH at that color change. Let's imagine we're working with a hypothetical indicator that has a pKa of 8.5. If we were to start with a neutral solution and add base to it, we would eventually increase the pH beyond 8.5 and we'd end up with a red solution. On the other hand, if we were to start with this pH 7 solution and add acid to it, we'd be decreasing the pH, and in doing that, all we're doing is increasing the concentration of HA, the acidic form, so the solution would remain blue. The lesson here is that if you're adding a lot of acid or base and not seeing a color change, try adding the opposite reagent. Add base if you've been adding acid and vice versa to move the pH in the other direction. You may already be on the side of one color and just pushing further and further toward that side. The question to answer as you do this process of changing the pH and looking for a color change is, at what exact pH value does the color change occur? We'll do this for phenylphthalein, and you'll pick one other indicator that has different colors and different pKa values to determine that so-called crossover pH.